pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, any additions to the agenda? Must be a no.
Oh, no.
I move to accept the agenda.
Motion and second, approve the agenda. All favor, say if I was saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries, minutes, approve minutes of the 10:03 meeting.
Oh, can I make a change? If you look at page two, I think that, page four, I think it should read the third paragraph down, fourth paragraph, Young provided an update on personnel committee's discussion with AT office on access to VPN. Young also noted county's internal policy of granting VPN access, and then leave the rest of it the same. Because otherwise it, we gave an overview of the summary and we discussed the internal policy, but I think that more accurately reflects it.
I move to approve the minutes with the change that Becky stated.
Second.
Motion second, approve the minutes with changes. All favor, say if I was saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Liberty, Human Services.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Warrants. Governor Malt.
Chairman Staples reviewed the private warrants before today's meeting. The total is $183,632.62. The main drivers in that increase in number would be our contracted rate amount that we could see with community medical center four times a year. And then also we had a medical assistance estate recovery, and in that we get the full amount, and then we are billed by the federal government 50% and by the state 25%, and then we keep 25% of that recovery.
Move. Okay, motion and second, approve the Human Services warrants for $183,632.62. Any discussion? All in favor, say if I was saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Social service contracts.
Yes, so we are starting to get our 2018 contracts. We have two contracts with Human Social Services. And in the past, I had provided all the contracts, and then we had agreed upon that unless there's major changes, significant changes, we should provide that signature form. The two contracts are for family-based services and treatment foster care services, and we do have both of those line items budgeted in 2018.
Move to approve the Human Social Services contracts.
I'll second.
Okay, motion and second to approve the 2018 Lutheran Social Service contracts as presented. All in favor, say if I was saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Thank you, Liberty.
Thank you.
Deputy Auditor Treasurer, you're up. We just received these, so.
Yeah.
I realized when I grabbed mine that I can't.
Take a minute or two to run through.
What's the one on page one of the page 10 for?
City of St.
you see the, one of the big ones on there was $40,000, the new UPS system, and that, there's some associated charges with that, we'll get revenue back for that from insurance claim. One of the big ones that were on there.
So what's the $8,400 for the Polk County Auditor's Treasury?
That is reimbursement for you.
Oh, sure.
Yep.
Yeah, I hope that Auditor's Treasury will be veterans, right?
Yeah, Veteran Service Officer, yep.
Yep, thanks.
We had all of our allocations too, I think, came out of here, like SWCD, SCIC, so that was another big chunk of funds.
Any other questions on auditors' reports?
Motion to approve.
How about Commissioner's warrants?
You think that's funny, huh? Is this the 80s dances?
I have one on page 11. The SCMC one, drug alcohol back screening, is that usually that high?
List and different choice.
Yep.
Oh.
Actually, I'll say I thought it was maybe a little bit higher.
It's on the very top of the page.
Yep.
Okay, so all funds is $238,186.71. With Commissioner's warrants.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, motion second to approve Commissioner's warrants. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Thank you. Okay, Karen.
Good morning.
Morning.
How's everybody here today?
Good.
Well, you know when you usually see my face, it's usually some good news, so, but I do want to give you some, a little bit of highlights. This last year, being July 1st of 2016 to June 30th of 2017, the 8th Judicial District Drug Court has to date 15 graduates. We have 6 in the Northern Assignment Area, 7 in the Central Assignment Area, which the Northern Assignment Area, to remind you, is Grant, Stevens, Traverse, and Wilkin County. The Central Area is Meeker and Candy. They have 7 graduates. And then the Southern Assignment Area has Swift and Chippewa at the time of this dictation. And they had 2 graduates. Since the beginning of the court in July 2014, there has been 1 graduate charged with a new felony controlled substance crime and 1 graduate charged with a misdemeanor dishonor check. So again, statistically, 75% of all graduates don't see handcuffs again or get charged with a new criminal offense. We feel like we're doing an adequate job there and better than national standards. Some of the benefits that we've seen in the last overall in our graduate program is that all of them are required to do a 50-hour community work service or volunteer project. So in our 15 that have graduated, that's a $6,000 benefit back to the community overall. 8 of our graduates did not have driver's license upon entering into drug court, and upon graduation, all 8 that did not have their driver's license did have their driver's license prior to graduation. 5 did not have their high school diploma or GED. 3 of them obtained that while they were in our program. and upon entering our program, 11 graduates were unemployed or only working part-time, and at the time of their graduation, 10 were working full-time. At the time, one on part-time. There were 3 active CHIPS cases closed on individuals while participating in our program. So that's talking about our graduates overall in the district. Our current participants, looking at jail time specifically, prior to entering our program, jail time throughout the district was 1,049 days. It's a significant amount of cost to the counties. Since the drug court program, 129 days have been served by our current participants in the program. A majority of those were waiting treatment beds. So that's sometimes the issue is getting people into treatment programming. Currently 17 participants are employed. Of the remaining 11, 5 are in primary treatment, 1 is in a halfway house, 1 is on warrant status, and 4 are seeking employment. So again, the majority of our participants are currently employed. In addition, active participants have paid almost $3,500. This was as of July of 17. In old fines and fees, and completed community work service for an additional amount of about $1,100. Individuals are allowed to continue working in their volunteer program to continue to work off some old fines and fees. We find a majority of our participants have numerous old traffic offenses and balances on old files, and we really want to work with them on getting them cleaned up as well prior to graduation. Specifically for Stevens County in the last fiscal year, there are 8 referrals from Stevens County. 3 were accepted into drug court, 1 was denied by the county attorney, 1 didn't meet the criteria, and 3 were denied based on residency. Unfortunately, if there are people that are not living in an active participating county, they cannot be in our program. So we continue to reach out with our partners, to our partnering and neighboring counties that are not participating, to see if we can get them involved in our program. The northern assignment area, there have been 3 graduates from Stevens County, 2 from Grant, and 1 in Travers. Of that specific group, 5 did not have their driver's license, 3 were unemployed, and upon graduation, 4 had their valid driver's license. 1 had a limited license with should be reinstated here fully in November, and all 3 were working full-time. The other 3 graduates had been working at the time of the entrance of our program. Jail sanctions prior to drug court totaled 48 days in the northern assignment area. And while in drug court, there were 2 additional days, again, a significant cost savings. And specifically to the northern assignment area, there were $2,400 given back in that volunteer program that they're required to do. And we find the majority of our graduates do continue with their volunteer program. Currently, Stevens County has 11 participants in the program. There are also 5 other participants with your neighboring counties. But today, specifically, we are here to talk about the next Stevens County graduate, Brock Proudfoot. Brock has been with our program since May 19th of 2016. At the time of his graduation, he will have over 415 days of sobriety. He will appear in court 30 times and undergone over 150 urinalysis tests. So, we really do try to keep on top of their use, and we find that that's a really good tool for them to be testing on a regular basis. He has maintained a stable residence and employment. completed his 50-hour volunteer project at the local Morris Theater Co-op, and continues to volunteer there as his job allows today. So we would like to cordially invite the Stevens County Board to his graduation, which will occur on November 2nd of 2017 at 3 o'clock here at the Stevens County Courthouse. And as usual, we'll have drug court and then his reception immediately following. So, thoughts, comments, questions, or concerns?
I'd just like to say, I've been thinking about this since we had a meeting. And, you know, it was brought up, do we think that, that drug court is valuable, is a valuable use of the resources in Stevens County? And the statistics bear that it is. But also, when someone's in drug court, and we've heard it time and time again, that's the longest they've been clean. That's the longest they've had, you know, that they've had stable employment. And so, if they've never been able to do that before, they had nothing to really strive for, or nothing, no way to know that that was possible for them. So, I absolutely think drug court is worth the resources that we're putting into it. So.
I do believe we're making an impact on people's lives. Is it perfect? No, but it's one more tool in the toolbox to address an ongoing concern in this community and communities surrounding us, and that is the use of illegal substances that hinder people's lives to move forward.
Yep.
As far as the investment goes, it's pay me now or pay me later, so it's better to get it now and cost less, and hopefully get straightened out and be in the court system later.
Well, and it's hard to figure in all the payback they give to the community, because once they're working, they are paying taxes, right. They are spending that money in our community, and for me to analyze and statistically gather that data, that portion of the data is not inclusive, so.
Well, and also when they're doing better, the kids that are living in that home are living in a stable home, which then they're doing better as well. And there's no way to assess the value on that either.
Karen, you said that he appeared in court 30 times in the last year and a half or whatever.
Correct.
Is that part of the
drug court process?
Well, just the drug court. Okay.
Yep. So they're required to appear in front of the judge every 2 weeks.
Okay.
Through the first 3 phases of our program, and then monthly the last 6 months.
Okay.
Until they graduate.
Oh, okay.
So again, it's just that holding them accountable, making sure you're on the right path. Oftentimes in the criminal justice system, on a probation case, someone's out in the community on probation, and they may see their agent once or twice a month. And then if there's a violation, the agent will work with them, and then if there's a second violation, then they'll bring it back into court. But that process takes so long, and the immediacy is the important thing. And so if there's a violation within 2 weeks, every 2 weeks we're seeing them. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. Have a great day.
Stephanie, update us on the watershed management.
Yeah.
There.
Mm-hmm. So my name is Stephanie. I'm the Pondicherry coordinator. Jeannie serves on Joint Powers Board, the Pondicherry River Association. Joint Powers Board between Ottertail, Douglas, Grant, Stevens, Swift, and Big Stone County to help take care of the Pondicherry River and its surrounding watershed. So over the past 10, 11 years, Pondicherry has been able to bring in over $2 million in clean water funds from the Board of Soil and Water Resources back to the Pondicherry watershed to bring conservation efforts, education, monitoring efforts here so that we know what's going on in our water with our water resources and what we can do about them. And then also helping SWCDs be able to provide cost share projects to get projects on the ground to help reduce things like sediment runoff. So phosphorus and nitrogen are two of the largest pollutants of our river, and the projects that we put in place help reduce the amount going into our streams and polluting our waters, which can affect fisheries, they can affect swimming abilities. You might see things like algae blooms are a really big deal around here. Currently, we have listed 3 lakes that are definitely impaired for nutrients. So those would be our priority lakes to work on. They have lower fish populations, and other organism populations are impaired. There's concerns for the future of what it could mean to those lakeshore owners. It reduces value of their property. And the same thing could go along with our river as well. What we're doing, we had a 10-year plan, and now we're creating a new 10-year plan, which is basically going to help tell us what we're going to do with that money that we're getting brought into the Pomme de Terre. Before, it was with MPCA, we had what was called a watershed restoration plan. Now we're doing what's called a one watershed, one plan. Currently, each county has their own water plan, which we look at to help, you know, figure out what we want to do in each of these counties. Right now, the Board of Soil and Water Resources, where we get a lot of our funds from, they're pushing for counties to get rid of the individual county plans to create a watershed plan. And that is because that water doesn't flow on a political boundary, it flows on a watershed boundary. So what's happening upstream is affecting what's downstream, and that's what this one watershed plan is hoping to accomplish, as well as by going through this planning process, we'll be able to get more funding for it. So eventually, it's going to become this thing where we need this watershed plan to get the funding to put these conservation efforts on the ground. So what we're doing, next week, we're having two opportunities, public meetings open to everyone. And I wanted to specifically formally invite you, because you are both influential feet on the ground. You're working in the community. You have a good idea of what the community needs, what the community is looking for, what the issues in the communities are. And we're asking for your input on what that is based on natural resources, water resources. It's partially open house, so you can always come in and just take a look around. We'll have different booths open talking about soil health, water quality health, different cost share programs that are happening, what the Palm de Terre has been able to do for the watershed, what other SWCDs are doing for the watershed, and then we'll have activities for you to allow, or for you to put input into our plan. And we'll also be having a couple of short presentations along with more in-depth roundtable conversations regarding our water resources. This plan is going to be really important for us to get local input, because again and again, the planning committee working on this plan right now is really into wanting this plan to be very localized. They want it to be about our local issues, what issues you are having. A lot of times people, they hire consultants or they look to the state agency and they say, make a plan for us, here we go. And then those watersheds aren't happy because it's not really addressing what the local area actually needs. We want something that's actually gonna, you know, pertain to our local area. But to do that, we need local input. And the more local input you can put into our plan, the better the plan is going to be for the future, the better our plans will be for our funds to be used. So it's just, it's a thing where you guys would be a really great source to be there. I know Jeannie obviously is always providing input, but the more the merrier, and the wider we can spread it, you know, it's just the more the merrier. So on that, I want to keep it short. I have this just information on it. It's on October 23rd and 26th from 4 to 7. One of them is in Dalton, and the one on the 26th is right here in Morris at the old number one. Yeah, I just want to pass these around really fast.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Thanks, Steph.
Thank you.
Thank you, Steph. Okay, Janet.
Whoops. Not my day today, huh?
Which one is the
office
part
special temp employee? Can we add
that?
Make a motion, I would
assume.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, motion and second to add, what is it?
The Human Services Temporary Employee.
Human Services Temporary Employee. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries.
I'll start out with the callback agreement for IT, and this would be for Jim Weaver, the new IT systems technician. And this would begin November 1st. We feel he'll be ready, and I think he'll be ready to pick up the on-call work at that time after we end up. So I'm just looking for approval of that agreement. It's the same type of agreement we have with Vicki. Or I'm sorry, not Vicki any longer. We did have it.
Mr. Chair, I move to approve.
Second. Okay, motion second to approve callback agreement with Mr. Weaver. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries.
The second item is the victim witness coordinator. Looking to have your approval pairing Susan Hansen to fill that position at a grade 17 step one. The effective date has yet to be determined, but expecting late October, early November. Move to approve.
Motion second to hire Susan Hansen to fill the victim witness coordinator, grade 17 step one. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries.
And the last item then is approving the hire of a temporary employee, Karina Nakalas, as the office support specialist. Be for a 12-week period, 22 and a half hours per week, and then an additional 12 hours of training time with her current employee who will be on leave. It's a temporary position and will be grade 13, step one. The start date is unknown at this time, but expected late October or early November as well. And then this, again, is the budget neutral position. Once we pay out this employee their vacation that they have built and sick leave, and then with what's left in the budget, be able to cover the costs of this 12-week position.
This is a position you sent an email on, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought so.
Any discussion? Motion.
I move to make that hire.
Second.
Okay, motion second for approval to hire the human services temporary position. Karina Nakalas. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion. Opposed, motion carries.
Thank you. Be sure to stop in for the health fair on October 24th if you have the chance. Well, two, three, and then two shots.
Okay, Sheriff Freeman.
All right, good morning all. Essentially, we're here to talk about the K-9 program and a couple of issues that I would like to address. I guess the first thing is I would look to get a motion from you guys to accept the donations that we've accumulated to this point in the process. And as of today, we have $8,500 that has been donated to the K-9 program. There are some additional pledges that haven't come in yet, and there's some additional money that has not come through Rob at the Pete's Ranch. So the grand total right now as we stand is $9,140. Deputy Hensinger he's done an excellent job in a very short amount of time to raise this kind of money. I'd like to recognize him for that too. And we'll open it up for any questions you guys have, but I guess essentially what I'm looking for is a motion from you guys so that we can accept this money, these donations. And that's my understanding from the state auditor I'll kind of give you a little background why Rob from the Pizza Ranch is here. I had a discussion with a lady from the state auditor's office, and she essentially said that we as a sheriff's office can't really go out and ask for money. So that's why we brought Rob on board. So the donations came in through the Pizza Ranch. So instead of me coming here with 30 different checks for you guys to approve, we kind of funneled it through Rob at the Pizza Ranch. So we have to do it essentially one time. But also, if you entertain this motion, I would like to have it worded so that we can continue to accept donations. We're not, done today with accepting donations. So if it can be worded in a way where we can just continue to accept these.
I got a question on.
Yeah.
A year ago, less than a year ago, you came and asked to make a part-time officer full-time.
Okay.
and we needed it to reduce overtime, bailiff work, and et cetera. And that passed, and now, at the time when the other dog was retired, he wasn't retired, we let him go as a pet to the family, he was still, could have been in service. But my point is, how much time is this canine officer not going to be patrolling and doing bailiff work and reducing overtime? And I want to find that stuff out before I would vote on anything.
So to answer, I'll answer both your questions. Ron is going to be the canine handler, and we're not changing his schedule. We're not. What we did with Graham and Rico, and this was when Willis was sheriff, they thought it would be a good idea to have him work a straight 3-to-11 shift because of the dog. And at the time, I didn't necessarily agree with that, but I wasn't in any position to do anything about that. So we've had these discussions, and my plan is to not do that. It's not going to change Ron's schedule one bit. He's going to have all of his basic functions that he's doing right now with the dog. He's not going to not bailiff. He's not going to change the schedule to work a set shift. We have had a lot of incidents where we could have used the dog at 8 o'clock on a Tuesday morning. So it makes no real difference when the dog handler is out. There's not like a real, you know, one shift would be useful more than another shift. So we're not going to make any of those changes. He's going to work the shift he's working now and do the duties he's doing now. Just have it all.
Surely there must be training times. And
you know, what about the, it says there in the letter that you sent out about 12 weeks of training. Is he going to be gone during that 12 weeks also, or just the dog?
No, it'll be him and the dog.
So who's going to cover that 12 weeks?
We're going to make that happen within the schedule we have now with as much, we're not going to abuse overtime as best we can.
What size counties, how many counties have this? These questions were sent to you earlier.
I did some checking on that.
Why is it in a county our size that you feel the need for such an expensive? Because just the refit of the car is going to cost more than the donations.
I can speak to that too, but let me, one of your original questions about when Rico retired, I followed up on the questions that you had sent earlier. So I talked to Graham, who was Rico's handler here. Rico was last used in May of 2015. He had surgery for his TPLO, or whatever it's called in dog terms, in June of 2015. Graham didn't retire or resign from us until November 3rd of 2015. So the dog was already out of the picture before Graham resigned from us. So it was not even able to be passed on to a different handler. The dog was medically retired several months before Graham resigned. So, as far as other counties that have them, Polk County has one dog, but it's for narcotics and tracking only. So basically, black lab or yellow lab, I don't remember what it is. Douglas County has two. The State Patrol in Douglas County has one. And then there are no other counties around us that have any. So if we're in a situation where we need one, they're Douglas County is the closest to trying to help us. So that kind of plays into the need for us. There's not one, we don't have dogs surrounding us that we can rely on. And we need to have one. In situations where you need a dog, it's time is of the essence. So
did the making the full-time officer, the part-time officer full-time, reduce overtime?
I would have to look at those numbers. I don't have them off the top of my head.
Because now the adding a dog is going to take time. There's just no way but it's not out of his day. So I'm just, for the size of our county and with the, we've got a lot of things that we have to spend money on, and I just don't, I question the need for this.
One thing I want to tell you is my plan for this is to have a zero impact on the budget. I'm not here asking you guys for money. I'm here asking for you to accept the donations so that we can make this happen. My plan is to, I understand there's going to be some ripple effect of costs, but my plan is to cover that in the budget that we currently have.
Here's my problem with this is I'd like to have you come before this, before we started donations and stuff. It kind of puts us on a spot here that we've already got the donations and the letter says it's so important to the county and stuff.
Yeah,
it really puts us as a board in a tough spot. That's,
and I apologize for that. This happened really fast. And maybe Ron can talk about the timing of the kennel that we're getting this dog from. They get dogs once a year, and it's coming up here in October, early November. So I apologize for that, but we were kind of stuck in a time frame here. And I also didn't, I didn't know how the donation thing was going to go. I didn't know if we were going to get 50 bucks or...
When we talked before, when we retired the dog and stuff, we never decided on the need back then. We kind of left it as an open-ended thing, and so this is
right. When Rico retired, I put it out to all the guys who wanted to keep this program going.
Yeah.
And at that point, we didn't have any interest in it. So.
That's how I remember it too. So.
So over the past 2 years since we haven't had Rico, how many times have we had to have one? Canine come to Stevens County, and then how is that paid for when you have someone bring a canine to Stevens County?
I'm trying to think off the top of my head how many times. Not a lot, but we haven't had to pay for one. When it's an emergency situation, it's
mutual aid, or
mutual aid. It's no different than people going and helping each other. I do know that the school in Hancock uses the Polk County Sheriff's Office dog to do their locker searches and things like that. The school here, Morse, hires a private company to do that.
Would they continue?
That's up to the school. I mean, if they approached us and wanted to do it, I think that's where we could charge for services for things like that, or for businesses. What I want to avoid is those mutual aid situations where people need help. I want to start charging for it, because then when we need help, then they're going to be charging us for it.
I'm trying to remember, when we had Rico, would he go along on, we do a fair amount of search warrants for drugs. Would Rico go along on those? And, I could see where he'd be really...
Absolutely.
Can you speak to that a little bit about how, how he would assist in a search warrant?
If we do a search warrant now without a dog, it's 5 or 6, 8 law enforcement agents. And we have to search, just think in your mind places where you could hide a little baby adult. We have to search an entire house. And it takes hours and hours. When we had Rico, he'd literally run through the house, and it would take him 5 to 10 minutes. And he would alert on places, and then we would focus our attention on searching those places, rather than wasting several hours searching the entire residence. As far as search warrants for narcotics, that was an invaluable tool to have.
How about the stops? If you've got a vehicle stopped, and let's say somebody has marijuana in the vehicle or other evidence of drugs, how do you use the dog then?
Well, that's another key factor is timing on that, because when we stop a vehicle, we can't hold that vehicle any longer than we normally would during a normal traffic stop. So to call a dog from Polk County or Douglas County, it can't do that because that would make that time too much. And the stop would be extended too long. If we have a dog right here, boom, they could get out there within that shortened time frame that's needed to not extend the stop beyond the reasonable time.
What about other things, Jason, like missing people?
Absolutely. Missing, and we're not talking about just bad guys here we're looking for. If we have a missing kid in the cornfield or a person from a group home, the dog's trained in tracking that scent. And just because the dog is tracking someone doesn't mean that when they find them, they're going to latch down on their leg. That's all, you know, covered in the training and the handler. So the dog is a tool. Obviously, we can get along without it. There's agencies that do. But it's just another tool to help us do our jobs. So, can I stand on that? Go ahead.
So, being on the road, I can test firsthand how much we need a canine. Not only the traffic stops that not only us, but the PD university running through. When we had Rico, it was invaluable, you know, especially out at the university, all the kids with marijuana, the drugs going through, always getting those. The traffic stops, I can't tell you how many traffic stops I've been on to where I try to dig, get further in. I know there's something in that car, but I can't get the reason to search it. And when we had Rico, it was a valuable tool. It was, hey, Grant, can you come up? And sure enough, you get alert when we get those drugs. School searches, Hancock has actually approached me, and I say, hey, you guys dog, canine, we'd like to get you in the school. So the schools is a big one. I touched on that one. Search warrants are huge. We're doing search warrants quite a bit. And just the amount of manpower that we won't need there, it just cuts the time in half. Like I said, it's a tool that we need, and I firmly believe that, and all. We need it, just like we need our radio, our cups, everything else. We need them, you know? I can think of about 2 weeks that we run into a situation where we need a canine. So it's not that we don't need one. It's not a one at this point, it's a need.
What kind of dog is this from this kennel?
It's the same as Rico. I mean, Malinois, I think I'm saying that right, or German Shepherd Cross. So it'll be the same type of dog as Rico, coming from the same place over in Europe. Same training.
The same company that we purchased Rico from.
They do an awesome job. I mean, Rico, I'd have to look at the stats, but 17 kids end up locating in his 8 years with us. If we didn't have Rico, they might have been found. Who knows how that would turn out? It's always split what if. The amount of drugs that you got off the streets, out of the schools, away from the kids. You know, I'm thinking of this as to use it to help the community. I'm not thinking of this as money. I don't think you can. Money-wise, we've got that part covered. So we're not here asking for money.
You're okay with that? I mean, it's going to be challenging for you too. I mean,
it is. When Rico retired, yeah. I was asked that, and I wanted the dog, but I wasn't ready. Okay. One, I had to learn my job. Two, I didn't really know anything about drugs at the time, so I've dedicated a lot of my time to working on drugs. Now I know I'm ready. So it's, and that's the problem with these other counties that don't have PIs, because it's one, money is an issue raising funds, and the other big one is finding an individual willing to do that. Yeah. It's just because you're a canine handler doesn't mean you can. And it's, you can't serve everything else. I still have to do transport, still have to pay, I have to do everything. But on top of that, I've got a dog. And there's not too many people who want that responsibility. And I'm 100%, over 100% willing to do that.
And I wouldn't let Ron even go down this path if I didn't think he was ready for it. Because it's, I think I've explained to you guys before, having a dog is, that takes a different amount of dedication. And it's a lifestyle change, essentially. I mean, and if somebody's not in it 100%, I don't want anything, you know. If it's not going to be 100%, I don't want to do it all. Especially in the dog, there's a lot of responsibility that comes with that, and I think Brown is ready for it. Where I'll agree with him, I don't think he was ready for it when Rico retired, and I asked all of the guys, anybody wanted this, and I had Ron in mind at that point, but we talked about it, and he was fairly new to the sheriff's office at that point, and wanted to learn how to do the job, first of all, and I have to applaud for that, for not fighting off more than he could chew.
And that's not something I can take on and then a year down the road go, I don't want this.
Oh, no,
that's not an option.
You're in.
This is for the next 7 to 9 years of my career. I will be with the dog. So it's a huge commitment, and I'm totally committed to it. I'm ready.
So what would you say our drug climate is in Stevens County now compared to where it was 5 years ago?
It's getting worse.
First, I agree with that. I think it's worse now than it was 5 years ago.
That is a huge problem. It's coming in because it's so cheap right now. It's everywhere. That's a huge problem. That's another reason for the can.
You've always,
you know, get those away.
Everyone's heard the news media reports of the heroin, and it's we've seen it here a little bit. It's not an epidemic status here yet, but I was working when meth wasn't really here yet either, but we could see it coming and what would happen to that.
I did look up the budget question. So right now, year-to-date, they're 83% of budget for overtime, but you have to preface that with the fact that we have reimbursement coming for the incident this summer. Your overtime is high because of that, and I think we're waiting to hear about mutual or reimbursement from the state. The other piece of that is actually the budget 2 years ago dropped $10,000 in budgeted overtime, and then we've stayed within that budget. It's just a proposed, so 16, 17 actually dropped $10,000 in overtime. And then this year we went slightly back up because we were doing it on projections through the summer, but that included that overtime from the storm event this summer. So actually overtime is overall down, even though you're trending high for this year to date. And when Jason mentioned that the board has to accept the donations, that's true. It goes into 206, but that's a restricted fund. So those donations stay restricted for that canine purpose. So what you're agreeing to, though, is you're agreeing to ongoing levy to support that program, which has historically been about $2,000. That includes $260 of MCIT insurance. It's $261 as a property rider on the animal. It's Jane Henninger referred to it as life insurance, essentially, for the animal if it was killed in the line of duty. And then the other piece of that is liability insurance for any accidents, injuries that occur from the result of using that animal in the line of service. And then the rest of the remainder of that would be for food, vet bills, ongoing annual expenses. And then Jason and I did look at the budget a little bit, and some of the things that he talked about is trying to leverage that handguns fund to try to use it. And we could move some wages for office staff over there and use some of those funds that are left in that department to cover any of the remaining expenses for that animal. So it would remain a budget neutral position going forward.
I know it was budgeted $2,000 a year in the canine budget, but historically, yeah. I think the most he spent in 1 year was $1,500.
Yeah, about $1,581.
And those funds, because it's a fund too, will carry over. So, like I said early on, I'm not here asking for money. I think we can do this under the current budget we have now.
Can you explain, because I'm really naive about this. So when you mentioned about a traffic stop, and you know there's drugs in there. So tell me the difference between that and having the dog.
So when I get up there, and just by the way the person's acting, most of us have been to a lot of schools, pick up on cues the way people are acting. Start talking with them, their answers don't match up, get them out of the car, talk to them. At that point, you can ask them, hey, mind if I search your vehicle? Sometimes they say yes, sometimes they say no. But you have to have a reasonable suspicion to get into that vehicle, more than just what they're saying there. Having a canine, you know, if I can build that up and I have him there, he can just walk around the car. And if he gets a sniff, I'm in. And I can hold that vehicle. I can say, all right, you can go down the road, but I'm holding your vehicle.
So if he alerts,
over a search warrant. Yeah.
If he alerts, then you have reasonable suspicion to search.
Yeah, I got probable cause for getting there. So the canine is. I can't keep the driver there. He's free to go. But I now control that vehicle. I can buy and obtain a search warrant and get in there and get drugs and later track down that owner of whoever. So it's a huge tool. I mean, when Rico was here, most of the time I was at the university, so I didn't assist a whole lot. But when I did with the traffic stops, it's unbelievable. You know, the canine shows up and goes, all right, it's here. You know, it's amazing. Huge tool.
One other thing I want to mention is we have two bite suits, a bunch of bite sleeves, all that stuff that we purchased with Rico, we still have that here.
Is there a vest bought for him as well?
Yeah, we still have that too.
Yeah.
So we have a lot of the basic equipment that we need for the dog.
Could you speak a little bit to, you know, I think a lot of people kind of wondered, well, how do you know that dog isn't just alerting on a piece of steak or, you know, the cop's giving him a little wink to say, hey, we need to alert there. I mean, how do you prevent against that kind of thing?
That's just constant training. The initial school you go to for narcotics is a month long, and it's a very intense course. So they're not only training me, but they're training the dog, and it's a reputable trainer. You go through that course, and how they do it, I haven't been there yet, so I'm not sure how, what the details are, but it's constant work with that dog to train him when they have any type of drug out there on how to alert, whether it's sit, scratch, or whatever the dog's trait will be for detecting. And then from there, it's just constant training. I think, like when Graham had Rico, it was weekly, daily, they train with Rico. So you're constantly getting that training. The company we're also buying, purchasing through and training, they have a lifetime guarantee, pretty much. If there's any problems, you come back, or you can come back and train to kind of like, keep the dog in it. If you start seeing problems, and the dog's, he's messing up in this area, you go back to the school and they'll retrain. Just kind of upkeep, more or less. So.
For no additional?
Yeah, no additional.
That's just a refresher course.
There you go. That's what I was looking for. Refresher course.
$15,000, because that's what it's going to cost if you do this, and you're at about $9,000 now. What if you don't reach the $15,000? Where's that going to come
from? We have forfeiture money available, and we have contingency money available. And as far as the cost of the school, that will come out of our existing training budget, which we're getting an additional, $7,000 from the post board this in 18 for training funds, which I had already put in the book. So
that money includes the cost of redoing the car?
Nope, that's that's in this list. So we'll talk about the car for a little bit. We use Code 4 up in Pelican Rapids, and Ron checked with them on the cost of the cage itself and the door popper and things like that. And then his labor to install this would have been $5,400. Basically, that's what he would charge anybody that would come in to do this, the equipment and the labor. But he's worked a deal with us because we've been using him for the last probably 7 years. He's only going to charge us half of his labor rate, and we're getting the cost of the cage at his cost. He's not going to add his, inflate that up like he would normally do with his equipment. So $3,800 will get us the car, what we need for it all.
And with donations, we're almost there already. Kind of touch on your question. If it all falls through, yeah, we have a backup plan. But I firmly believe there's no way this could fall through because of the amount of support that we've already seen. We got Morris Vet for a year, just free vet care, for your basic exams. Code 4 donating. Just the amount of donations that we've gotten from the community in a short amount of time shows us that the support's there. And it's not done yet, but all kinds of people still want to donate and give money. So I think we'll get there with no problem whatsoever. That's my belief.
I still think it's going to take more of your time off, though. I already did this, made that full-time officer.
Take more time off what?
I still think it's going to take more time away from patrolling and doing the bailiff work, and I just...
I don't know how.
Stevens County is a small county.
Well, as far as bailiff work, I mean, that's something that we don't have a choice in the matter. We have to do it. So.
And overtime.
So if Ron has, if we need a bailiff and Ron is the only one working, he doesn't really have a choice in the matter, he's going to be bailiff.
just because I have the canine and someone needs one out in the county doesn't mean I automatically have to go there. I still have my duties as a deputy to fulfill first before the canine. Canine's extra.
So we make the dog a court attendant for jury trial? That'll work.
You needed something.
You should buy a female dog then.
There you go.
There you go.
Oh. I get. I'm hesitant about doing this until the 15,000 is reached. I mean, but I guess it's up to, because we'd have to have a motion to accept the, what's the amount that you have currently?
8,500 through the Pizza Ranch, and then
exactly 8,500.
And then with additional funds that we have right now is 9,140.
Yeah, right. We can only do the 8,500 at this point.
We can. Yeah, I was thinking you could do a motion to accept ongoing, but I think it works like the youth activity fund. You have to accept.
I think they have to be funds in hand to do it.
I think that would apply to this fund
yes.
too.
So I guess we'd have to do a motion to accept the 8,500 in donations for the canine unit at this point. And then as more donations come in, we'd have to approve them.
Come back in.
So we can do it like we are now, where
yeah, you can bring a lump sum.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So not every check we get, we're going to
come. Oh, no.
In.
Unless Rob just wants to make it 15 today.
Yeah.
That's what he's on the list.
That's trying to help you out.
Hey, Rob, thank you for helping out.
Yeah. Before we make a vote, I would just like to say that next time you send out a letter, I would appreciate it if it would come before us before it goes out so we can read it.
That was my point earlier. That,
I guess I'm not, I don't like the process that was used.
Yes.
I mean, we're kind of under the gun here to approve this. We're just found out about it when the agenda came out. So
well, the only reason we got a copy of the letter is it was handed to us at a different meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And I just thought it was a terrible way to find out that this was going on.
So
well, I move to accept the current $8,500 in donations for the canine.
I'll second.
It'll cost you a push-up.
Motion and second to accept the $8,500 in donations toward the canine unit. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
So do we get to meet him when we get
him? Absolutely.
Really?
Hey, Mr. Kleindel.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, we've got a portion of our demolition debris landfill that's come to its final fill elevation, in which the rules require that we need to cover that with 2 foot of material and have it seated. Along with that, there's another area that's not at final elevation yet, but it's on the side slope that should be covered to prevent erosion from happening in the years until it's ready to be filled. And that's in the back southeast side of the landfill, in which we're progressing to the
southwest,
whatever. We're going back towards where the transfer station is. And then once we complete that area, then we come back and start filling in another phase. So the material that would be there could be pushed up and stockpiled until it's needed for cover at different points when we're filling that phase. So I got one quote from Miley Brothers. They've usually got the quote before because the material is the other quotes that we've had in the past, and it was higher because they were a haul for it. So I brought this for you today to see if you wish me to have them put this cover on this fall, as well as they also have a quote from Vicki Dozdahl to seed those areas. That was for $1,800, and the material and the putting in place cost from Riley Brothers was $32,212.50.
Need separate motions for that?
No, I don't believe so.
Just curious.
We also have to have Riley's roll of sheet foot across the capacity. So I guess this is something that has to be done. It's part of the demolition rule requirements, and it's part of the reason that we raised our per yard demolition landfill. So for the first two quarters of this year, for instance, you've taken in $20,858 to go towards activities like this. Last year, for a total, county's portion of that tipping fee was $47,929.
So there's money in the fund to do it?
There is, yes. You know, we shouldn't have to do this. The last time we did it was in 2012 for final cover, so it should be another few years before we're going to have to do that again. But there again, the unforeseen cost of this groundwater probing that's going to be happening here in October or November, who knows what the additional cost will be. And there may come a point where the county board's going to have to make a decision whether to continue demolition landfill or not.
And the EPA wants us to put 5-foot fill on next time. I mean, their current proposal.
Well, their proposed draft that they sent to us, they wanted 5-foot cover, which isn't required in the current rules. So our response back to them was no, it's not in the rules, and there's no scientific evidence that 5 foot is going to be more good to prevent groundwater contamination than 2 foot.
So you're going to double this cost to do the 5 foot.
So there again, that may come a point where the county board's going to have to make a decision to continue or not. And if you want to continue, the cost is going to have to go up quite a bit to cover those closure costs.
I'd move to get Joe Riley Construction to put 2 foot of cover on at $32,212.50 and get Vicki Dozdahl to seed it for $1,800.
Second.
Okay, motion and second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.
That was Riley Brothers.
Yeah, Riley Brothers. Yes. All right, that's all I have.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Scott.
We got a petition to start the county ditch 21 here, Mulberry, so ago. About 1.25 miles of ditch along section 30 in Stevens Township. Another part to that, when we were inspecting it.
Oh, riprap in?
Yeah, I put some riprap in, which is, that whole ditch system is, I don't know, necessarily in best shape, but. So yeah, we put some riprap in there a few years ago, and it's still kind of blowing out. So we're going to fill that whole spot in, and finish that spot off, so. We put out for bids. We got a really very good price from Riley Brothers for $1.10 per foot, which is we haven't seen in a long time. So, yeah, I guess we're just looking for a motion to
We have a motion for $11,268 to Riley Brothers for clean out ditch 21 at riprap.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Scott.
All right.
County coordinator. is next. Trailblazers, first.
Yep, there is just their annual agreement to administer the grant contract. Just to need a motion to sign and approve that contract.
Motion.
Okay, motion second for the West Central Trailblazers grant and aid trail contract. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Mako dues.
We have those in the 2018 budget, and I just was bringing them for you to approve the funding. We haven't approved the final budget yet.
So we have to pay the 18, so, correct?
They don't know, but yeah, we have to pay them before 2018. I just thought I'd get them off my desk. They are in the 2018 budget, and they're in the preliminary levy. Do you want me to, I can hold it. I think we always pay them like in December, so they actually go on the previous years.
Move to approve.
I'll second that.
Okay, motion to approve the Mako dues of $450. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries.
Due to legislative changes, we have a deferred comp plan that we offer for employees. As a governmental entity, we can offer 457B. There are some legislative changes that had to do with the plan document and how the plan is administered. So our representative has reviewed the document and recommended that the board approve those. And I guess I'm just recommending that you approve those so that we can go ahead and sign and execute that document. There's nothing, there are changes that have to be made due to legislative updates.
So we have a resolution for that?
A motion to approve the updated county's deferred comp plan document.
I so move, Mr. Chair.
Do we need that as a resolution?
There's a resolution.
There's a resolution in the packet.
Oh, there was, I think.
Yeah, there was.
Okay, now we need the resolution.
Sorry.
Yeah, more than just that for the board. Yeah, motion or resolution, I guess. If they want one, we can do one, I guess.
You made a motion for the resolution, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay, I need to approve the resolution on the comp plan.
Okay.
Lots of. Second.
Did I second?
Yes, you seconded.
Did we have a motion and second on that?
Yeah, they do, you're involved.
Yes, so they would have to.
Two of them.
So we need to vote on that one and put it.
Or they can accept a friendly amendment.
Friendly amendment.
Can I have a do-over today?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, motion to approve a resolution for.
Comp plan.
County's deferred comp plan, Mass Mutual. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries.
I do need a do-over.
Budget review.
Ooh, fancy graph.
Well, only one of them, so I'll get real impressed. I'll do better next quarter. Maybe one's all we need. Okay, take the front sheet with the green, yellow, and red first. Oh.
I'll get your copy after me.
Yeah. Get you guys an extra copy here when I'm done. Okay, I sent out the report and it had a lot of detail in it. If you want to take your attention to the front sheet with the green, yellow, and red on it. So on top, this is actually year to date. So for third quarters in, we expect to be about 75% on revenue and cost, but there's a few exceptions to that. Fund one, you can see that we're 62% of actual revenues and 72% of actual expenditures, so tracking pretty on target for that 75% that we'd like to see this time of year. Revenues, and you'll see that on the first line there, the second half collections are actually taking place now between October and November. So we're actually over accrued on revenue, and I'll tell you why in just a minute. We'd actually expect to see revenues across the funds at 50%. But there's a reason why we actually got a little bit more there. Fund three, our road and bridge fund, you can see that we're 71% of revenues and 67% of actual expenditures. The caveat there is that there's a lag in some of the payments that are made for final, as well as some of the receipted revenues. So they're actually performing better than expected as well, even though we don't have those receipted. And then fund five, we have 66% of revenues collected. We're realizing a higher revenue on some of the services performed, but they also don't have their second half collected taxes received on there as well. They're at 70% of expenditures, and I'm going to caution you there. There's always a lag in expenses, and they're actually running higher year-to-date on expenses, and I'll explain that why in just a minute below.
What is Fund 5?
Fund 5 is Human Services, okay. Sorry. Kind of just put that, Human Services General Fund and Road and Bridge, lessons learned. So countywide, we're at 66% for revenue and 70% for expenses. Again, targeting that 75% for year-to-date. So if you look below, I highlighted some items of note by fund, and I went into a little bit more detail on fund one because we've been tracking some of the issues on Human Services and Road and Bridge as the years progress. So you kind of know some of the issues there. But so again, second half collections are taking place now for taxes. If you look at fund one, department four, that the revenue for PILT, there was a $67,000 increase in that. That was directly, they do assessment periods every 6 years to reassess the value of that land submitted to the state, and the PILT is calculated. We entered into a period where the new values were submitted, and then that directly impacted the amount of revenue that we received on PILT. So we had a large increase that we were projecting there for revenue, which was nice to see. Some of the concerns I have in countywide are the administration court costs. We've seen those exponentially increase. We're about $7,000. To the bad, I think by the end of the year we will be. And we increased that line item where that was tracking for this year, but I mean, every week it's $1,300 or $1,800. And so the $16,000 we had budgeted went through very quickly. We have $22,000 for next year.
Becky, that's that lawyer fees?
That's the lawyer fees for like court appointed, things like that, Aaron, right?
That's right.
So there's nothing we can really do to project where those are going to fall. But, you know, if we see an uptick in services from the Sheriff's Office, from Human Services, all that's going to translate into higher court fees, too. So we try to address that by correcting the budget next year. But I, you know, wouldn't be surprised to anticipate another increase for the year after that. Intergovernmental payments, that was a one-time payment for the assessment for a project that happened through the city of Morris. And so we didn't have that budgeted. Both Amanda and I weren't here when that was told that we were going to have to owe that in the future years. So that was from 14, from early 14. So that you'll see a negative 2,800 there that we didn't have budgeted revenue against.
What was that for?
It's for a street assessment for a project they did. So retirees' health, that is 12,000 to the good. That is for that health insurance for retired elected officials. That was sunsetted. We have another retiree done in December. And so 2018 has been decreased, but we're about 12,000 to the good for that. We just didn't know where insurance premiums would fall, and we were fortunate enough to have some extra in there. Professional fees were money to the good there. That's largely due to probably me not using legal counsel as much, so that legal counsel that we used, the board got credited there. And that's largely what was attributed to that fee, was either the comp study in the past or legal fees. Some of the things we want to watch is that employee recognition was over budget, but we're waiting for some reimbursement from Horizon Public Health on that, so that should break even. But as we try to do more, we want to maybe look at increasing that slightly just to be able to do more. That's been pretty successful this year. The employee engagement's been really well on the wellness and recognition. We've been attributing some wellness costs there too. IT, we are under 75 year date, so we're doing really well. All of our licenses have been paid for and stuff for the year. We had some savings on salary because that was already locked in and budgeted before we had some structure changes. But we've reclassified many items in there, so it's very hard to look at it line item by line item and say, are we doing okay? Next year, Vicki and I tried to clean that up, but what I'm watching is the overall cost that we're under that 75% year to date. In recorders, you'll see some money was moved there. The auditor treasurer determined that Office of State Auditor won't let an ongoing lease go to the recorder's fund, so that wasn't budgeted in the recorder's budget last year. It was supposed to go to the recorder's tech fund, and it didn't, so there's an increase there. Plus, they had some costs that were charged there for the failure implementation, and I may try to get those moved to the recorder's fund if I can, if there's enough revenue in there. So that may not be an add of 1500, I might be able to get that moved. Safety, those wages, we know in the first two quarters, no safety coordinator wages should be getting charged there, but they were for the third quarter, so I've had payroll re-correct that again. Those wages will move to EM, so that should be budget neutral. We need to watch sheriff's budget for 2018. We increased their dues line that wasn't being allocated right in there, and they're doing really well on fuel and some other contingency fees, but the dues were higher than what that line item was, and I think I've worked with him that we've got that corrected. We need to watch the coroner's budget. The costs are really trending a lot higher there, it's, you know, the unattended deaths, things like that, that get charged out. And again, there's really no way to project that. We've just kind of had our higher costs there, and there's some costs that aren't receipted that I've approved that aren't received on that quarter to date or year to date, but if you look, review that. Okay, so fund five, I'm gonna sum this up. I see I can't spell mental health either. I really do need to do over today. Out of home placement mental health, we're about over $100,000 over budgeted on out of home placement. And that's on the light side. We haven't finished realizing the cost yet for the year. There's a lag on that. You're well aware of the issues there. It's a variety of out-of-home placements from everything from, you know, foster care to foster care treatment type facilities or correctional facilities. And then, you know, we have a high number of children in out-of-home placement in general right now, higher than what traditionally has been in Stevens County, so that's a large concern. They did have a reserve spend down plan for the year. You know, they're receiving a little bit higher revenues. They historically budget lower than expected revenues. Just to make sure we're guaranteed that we don't levy too little. So, you know, we'll have to wait and see here another 1 or 2 months, bring in some of those out of home placements to really know what impact that'll be to fund reserves, if that makes sense. So they're receiving higher than anticipated revenues, but they have higher than anticipated expenses, and we had a fund spend down plan. So all that correlates to a large spend down in fund reserves, but I want to wait another month or two and kind of see what some of the expenses are there. The other piece is that mental health out of our placement has not hit the books yet. About $43,000 in counting does not meet medical qualifications, so still waiting for placement on that client, and so that is you know, adding another strain to the budget there on the human services side. So really the big concern for me, I guess, is the human services fund out of the three major funds. Fund three, which is our road and bridge, has some good news there. The bridge that was replaced this year, initially we were talking between $70,000 and $100,000. We thought would be levy funds for that County Road 70 bridge, but because Todd was able to leverage some other funding sources, it may be closer to $6,000 to $7,000 out of levy funds for that bridge because of the reimbursement from the federal end. They're really good on fuel, overtime, equipment. An example, they're like 38% expended of fuel spent, and that was out of that 340 department if you look there. Now, there's the caveat, if it snows next week, we might have a lot of fuel and overtime burn, but we're doing very, very well on those line items based on historical usage. And then the only thing that I caution to watch on is the equipment budget. They still have a tandem truck purchase scheduled for this year that hasn't been expended yet, nor has the truck purchase. It doesn't look like the truck. I think both of those are going to get tough to get built here in 2017, but they were budgeted for this year and they haven't been expended yet. So were there specific questions on the budget?
doing pretty well.
Oh, we're all doing very well, you know, just concerned with the human services, but again, that is costs that, the two line items are cost drivers are out of control, they're state mandated, and there's very limited reimbursement for. So, you know, overall, doing well where we expect year to date, a lot of good cash flow right now with taxes being collected, that'll help a lot. And some of the booths in Pilt were really a kind of a.
So, how many acres in Pilt do we have? We don't have like.
Oh, I can send you the report.
Yeah, I'm just kidding.
I have the updated assessor's report.
Because I talked to like Commissioner Anderson from Beltrami County and some of those, and they were three quarters of Pilt.
I'll send you the report.
It's a huge Pilt.
Yeah, I'm just curious, thanks.
Yep.
Don't make it a priority, you know.
So I'm still stuck on this random moment thing.
You mean the revenue that's received in the general, I can give you the answer because I asked somebody. That is, there's two different parts that are received on that.
Okay.
Some of it goes to the human services fund, some of it goes to the general. The general is for the indirect administration costs to administer those programs, so it is received, right?
Okay.
Should be received there, is what Dave said, because he said there's a large cost to the county for all the requirements that come with administering all those programs and managing that fund. So that's their revenue to process all the financial side of that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because especially if we're gonna get more long-term employees in there.
Yep.
It would be nice to have them receiving the income, especially when they're.
So there's a cost benefit report that's done every year by that GMG management group. I think you guys get copied on that. And that actually goes into detail on how that, if you wanna know, how the expenses are broke out, and they actually go and audit that every year, and they figure out the impact of that unit and the services on the other administration capacities that the county provides, human services, IT support, audit support, things like that. And that, how that's allocated and received in terms of revenue is based on that cost report.
Okay.
So. Okay, that's all I have. We need to close to talk about union negotiations, so. There's a motion to close.
Motion to close.
Second, that motion.
Motion second to close for union negotiations, all favors and commands, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, carries. Hey, commissioner reports. Done?
Sorry.
Motion second to adjourn, all favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, motion carries, thank you.